You know, last session we have already started unit number 4, design of worm gears or worm and worm gear. So what do you mean by worm and worm gear? You know, when to transmit power at 90 but non-intersecting, non-perpendicular sharp. This is one thing we have discussed again here in worm and worm wheel. Worm is a screw or having a threads on it. It's a driving element or driving member. Another member is a driven, that is worm wheel. It's having a construction like a helical gear. Again, main advantage of worm and worm gear is to transmit power at high velocity ratios. Again, velocity per speed reduction ratio, which is achieved at 100:1 in a single step. And if it achieves the velocity ratio as 100:1 in a single step, that means compact drive compared with helical bevels per hour. But as it, you know, the speed reduction ratio is high, but efficiency is low compared with the spur, helical and bevel gear. Spur gear is having more efficiency than the helical. Helical is having more efficiency than the bevel, and bevel is having more efficiency than the worm. And you know very well, near about 94% or 95% maximum efficiency you can achieve in by using worm and worm. Again, second thing, very important thing, worm is always a driving member, and its construction here, threads of the same shape as that of the annulus of the rack. That means, you know very well, last time we have discussed and I have told you, look at this. The worm is like a screw. Worm is like a screw. Once again, within 5 minutes, I will recap it. And this gear, you know, look at this. This is the worm wheel. This is the worm wheel. And this screw, this is a worm. Again, here, you know, the axes are perpendicular but non-intersecting. Try to understand. Again, for heavy duty transmission, high power transmission, maximum speed reduction, which is, it can be achieved, that is 100:1. But in actual practice, while designing industrial gearbox for hoist or cranes or lifting purpose applications, you don't go beyond 70:1, try to understand. It's okay. In specific condition, you can use it. That means when input shaft rotates at 100 RPM, you will get the output speed of 1, that is 100:1 reduction. But actual practice, maximum you have to go up to 70 or more than 25, or in one reduction you can achieve it. So up to 70:1 you can take in actual practice while designing the worm gearbox or worm and worm gearbox. Then materials use, I have already told you, dissimilar metals are used. Dissimilar metals. And why dissimilar metals? Worm is made up of, worm means this, like a crow, cast iron, alloy steel, cast steel, carbon steel. Carbon steel means plain carbon steel, 38, 45, 8, like this. Then worm is made up of softer material, and these softer materials are aluminium, brass, copper, plastic, and generally prepared material is phosphor bronze. And why different materials? So because of this, you know, when this always it's a driving unit or a driver, that means worm is connected to the prime mover or a motor, and it runs at a high speed. And here in it's having a, you know, the thread like construction, or you say like a screw. So how it transmits the power? Along with the rolling, there is a sliding friction. Along with the rolling, there is a sliding friction. And because of that, there is a, because of the friction, excessive heat generation. Then, this is one thing. Second thing, input or a worm, it rotates at high speed because high reduction is possible, and it rotates at low speed. Then, if we are going to use the same, you know, in spur, bevel and helical materials, we are using the same materials. And if same materials are used, the designs based on that, you know, which one is the weaker. Same material, pinner is always weaker. Otherwise, sigma B into Y product decides which one is the weaker. But in this case, the material used for the worm, that is alloy steel, cast steel, that means is having a high strength as well as high fatigue strength compared with the other. Why? Because if it is going to fail, replacement of the worm or a worm that is screw, which is costlier. Why costlier? Material is the one thing. Second thing, manufacturing of this, you know, the threads on this cylindrical rod, cost associated with this manufacturing, it's a difficult one. That's why cost is more. But here for the worm wheel, it's the simple one, is having, you know, the construction like a helical gears also, maybe straight or the spiral. And because of that, the material used for the worm wheel is the softer. And why softer? To accommodate, because along with the rolling, there is a sliding motion. How to accommodate with this, the threads of the worm with the teeth of the worm wheel? For that purpose, the conformability plays the important role, and phosphor bronze is having that property. So to avoid this friction, or there should be the low coefficient of friction, this is one reason to have a dissimilar metal. And second one is the conformability to accommodate this worm with the worm wheel. And that's why softer material which is used for the worm. These are the reasons. Sometimes in examination questions, why dissimilar materials are used, why softer materials are used. So you can elaborate in this way. Then you know very well in general the different applications, the gate control mechanism, that means in dams, then hoisting machines, atom boil steering mechanism, lifts, conveyor presses, spindle users. All these are, I have already discussed these things, but within 5 minutes I will recap of these things. Okay, then how it works. Many times I have told, worm rotates and drives the worm wheel. Worm and worm gear form a lower pair. Worm gear drive, power is always transmitted from worm to worm wheel. I have already mentioned. Power cannot be transmitted from worm wheel to reverse. It's not possible. So what is the reason? I will elaborate. And self-locking is the requirement in many application, to in lifting application, the hoist application, crane applications. That's why don't go for this, you know, the reverse transmission. Then it is highly useful many application I have told. And again, how to take this velocity ratio, like in other cases, you know, the Zg by Zp is equal to, you will get the velocity. In this case, it is determined number of teeth on worm gear, number of teeth on worm gear upon number of starts on one. And you know, in nomenclature, I have already told Z1 oblique Z2 oblique, you know how it is designated, Z1 oblique Z2 oblique Q oblique M. Z1 means number of starts on worm, Z2 means number of teeth on worm wheel, Q is the diameter quotient, and M is the module. Now here also, how this velocity ratio I is equal to Z2 upon Z1. In this way, you can find out. Again, another you can write down also, power transmission decreases with increase in velocity ratio as. Why? Because friction is going to increase, heat generation is going to increase, and there is a loss due to this excessive heat generation. But what are the advantages? Worm gear drives operate silently and smoothly. Self-locking, I have told, worm is the always driver. That's why self-locking property, you know, the friction angle pi, and it plays the important role here. I will elaborate that thing, self-locking. Occupies less space, because in one step or one stage, you can achieve maximum 100:1 reduction. Good meshing effectiveness, reducing speed and increasing torque, high velocity ratio. These are the advantages. But what are the disadvantages? Expensive. This is because of the worm gear material, phosphor bronze. Softer material is required to have a conformability or proper meshing. So that's why here we have written the advantage, good meshing effectiveness. Worm drives have higher power losses and low efficiency. This is because of friction and heat generation. And last one is the lot of heat generation. That's why, you know very well, worm and worm gear, they are dipped in oil. In other spur, bevel and helical gearboxes, you will find there is a splash lubrication. That means how much is the, you know, the quantity of lubricant in the casing, where the tip of the helical or spur which comes in contact with the lubricant, and splashing is the lubrication style. But in this case, worm and wormhole, which is deep in oil sump, because of this heat generation, and that's why while designing the worm and wormhole, thermal consideration or heat generation plays important role that we have to take into account. That's why design of this worm and wormhole is somehow different than the others one. There is one question, I will take that question. Sir, why do we need such a high speed reduction ratios? Can't we just change the motor or whatever in input driving system of low RPM and use different gears with greater efficiency and low cost? Because of that, you can use a number of stages, but harsh, but what is going to happen? The compactness, space availability, it is going to lose. This is one reason. Second reason, cost. As the number of stages are going to increase, number of machine elements are going to increase, cost is also going to increase. And that's why instead of using a, you know, the just change the motor and others, the, instead of that, we can use the simple, you know, the minimum number of elements to achieve it. Okay, Harsh, this is the thing. Again, you know very well, the efficiency point of view, I would like to give the answer. The, you know, the self-locking plays important role in worm and wormhole. So in some application, hoist, cranes, lifting applications, to hold at the proper position, the self-locking means, you know, the efficiency should be 50 or near about 50%. You know, Empower Pro already used today that thing. And that's why efficiency of the, you know, the gear drive is less to achieve that self-locking. That means self-locking is having that, you know, the relation. Okay. Then terminology. Last time we have discussed again here terminology. So how to designate the worm and wormhole by Z1, Z2, Q and M. You know very well what is Z1? Z1 means number of start. Try to understand here. Z1 means number of starts. Number of starts on what? Worm. Z2 means number of teeth on worm wheel. What is Q? Q is the diametral quotient. And what is M? M is the module, you know very well. And worm and worm gear here, which is specified by this in this way, Z1 oblique Z2 oblique Q by oblique. Look at this here. Suppose if it is the mention 1 oblique 20 oblique 10 oblique 5. So what is 1? 1 is Z1 number of starts, single start thread. Z2 20 number of teeth on worm wheel or worm gear, Q is diametral quotient, that is 10. And what is pi? Module is pi. Try to understand. In examination, they are going to write 1 oblique 20 oblique 10. What is this? Or by taking this value, find out center distance. Some like, you know, the objective questions may be asked. Okay. I hope you got it. Again here, but this diametral quotient Q, which is equal to, try to understand. Remember this diametral quotient Q is equal to D1 by M. M is the module. What is D1? D1 is the PCD of the worm. Look at this. This is the worm. What is this? This is the worm. And D1 is the PCD of the worm. D2 is the PCD of the gear. This is gear or worm gear. And this is worm. Look at this. Try to understand these things. Then, next important thing, sir, can you explain what is Q? I have told Q is the diametral quotient. And it's a ratio of P circle diameter of the worm upon module. Worm upon module. So instead of taking, you know, in the spur, helical, and other gear, what is the D? D is equal to M into Z, MZ. You know very well. But in this case, what is D? D1 is equal to Q into M. Q into M. Instead of taking here Z, the Q diametral question, the year, what is going to play the important role, which is based on this number of teeth, or instead of saying number of teeth, we can say number of starts on thread, because worm is having number of starts. It's like a, is having a construction like a screw. Okay. Then next, prepared values of Q. How much is the prepared values? In data book, it's given that is Q is equal to 8, 10, 12.5, 16, 20, 25. And if you would like to find out, Q is equal to what is D1 upon M. M is the module. D is one is the PCD, even though you will get the cube. But if it's not given, you can assume 8, 10, 12 point. All these are the prepared values of diameter question. Then another one, number of starts. You know very well in power screw already, you know very well single start, thread, multi-starts, thread. The number of starts as a 1, 2, 4. Now how to decide this? It is totally depends on velocity ratio. I will show one table. Sorry. Velocity ratio. Try to understand number of starts. The single starts or whether it's a double starts or a triple start or a multi-start like this. The year is having a relation. How to decide how to take the value of Z? 1 is equal to 1 to 4 depends on velocity ratio. I will elaborate that. Then look at in terminology. Px is the axial pitch. You can measure from this point on this the thread to the adjacent point on this thread. You can see it's the axial pitch measured along the axis. Then yesterday also here some of the terminology I have written. I will elaborate one by one. Look at this. The axial pitch I have told. Then second one is the lead. Lead is equal to Px into Z1. What is lead? In one revolution, how much is the axial moment of that screw? That is lead, you know very well. So it is given by Px into Z1. Z1 means I have written here, instead of writing Z1 means number of starts. Number of, write down, number of starts. For a single start thread, or single, when it's a single start thread, worm is having single start, so what you have to do? The Z1 is equal to 1, the lead is equal to Px. And for a multi-start, 2 start, you can put Z1 is equal to 2. In this way, you have to take. And look at this, as I have told, when, how to decide number of starts, it depends on velocity ratio. Look at this. When velocity ratio is 20 and above, you have to go for a single start. That means Z1 is equal to 1. When it is in between 10 to 36, you can take Z2 is equal to 2. Then triple starts, 8 to 12. Then quadruple, 6 to 12. Then sextuple, that means 6. And don't go for this quadruple and this. So here it is 4 to 6. Here what is going to happen? You will get a high speed, smoothness, noiseless, but efficiency is going to decrease. That is the thing. And if it is going to decrease, how it is going to take the load? That means relation with the efficiency and self-locking is going to lose. That is the thing. Try to understand. We have already studied in DME 1 also. It's okay. Then another one, what is the PCD of the worm wheel? D2 is equal to M into Z. As usual, like spur and helical. Z2 means number of teeth on worm wheel. And it's a PCD of the worm wheel or a worm gear. Then another, you know very well, as last time we have also told you, axial, here in this case, axial pitch of the worm is equal to circular pitch of the worm wheel. Why? Because they are non-parallel, non-intersecting, and there is a sliding and rolling. You know the how they are going to mesh. So you will find, even though I will show once again here, look at this here. If you are going to observe, you will find here, at this case, they along with this axial and if you are going to consider here, it's you know the you will find its circumferentially it is going to rotate this worm wheel. That's why this consideration you have to take into account, and that's why you will get this axial pitch is equal to circular pitch of the worm wheel. Try to understand. So what is this axial pitch? You know very well, or circular pitch pi into d into z2. You know very well this in term you are already studied. But what is d2? M into z2. You can substitute here, what you will get here, pi m. This circular pitch is equal to pi m you will get. Then again, what is the lead angle? I will explain again. Look at the figure earlier slide, lead angle, that is gamma. You will find here, what is lead? Lead is the distance travel in one revolution, that is lead it is given. Angle made by, you know, this is the angle made by the thread. The line drawn which is tangentially to the thread, to the line is normal to this worm. The angle made is thread, it's known as the thread angle. Try to understand. And this is the lead. And you can refer this. And you know, if you are going to open it, you know very well it's a pi d1. So L and this tan gamma is equal to L upon pi d1. You know very well, you can use your tan gamma. Samarchi bhuja bhagile lagatchi bhuja. L upon pi d1. So you can do the use this simple geometry. So that's why here I have written, look at this. Lead angle is equal to tan gamma is equal to L upon pi d1. Again, what is L? L is equal to this. Lead is equal to P into X. Then what is this? This is equal to pi into M. Pi into M. And then what you have to do? You can substitute the value of L. And here, this axial pitch is equal to pi M. So what you have to, lead angle is equal to tan gamma is equal to L pi D1. L pi D1. So you can substitute L is equal to pi mz. I am going to substitute here pi into m, sorry, you can substitute L is equal to pi into m into what z1. You can substitute here and what you will get, pi gets cancelled, you will write m into z1 by d1. But what is the relation with z1 and d1? It's a q. So what you will get, tan gamma is equal to, you can do this analysis, tan gamma is equal to, you can note down this point, tan gamma, to calculate the lead angle you have to use this relation z1 by q. How you got? L is equal to pi into m z1 upon pi d1, and you know very well q, diametral quotient, q is equal to, what is q? Q is equal to d1 upon m. You can substitute, you will get this. It's okay. Last time also we have discussed. Then what is A? A is the center distance. Again, you can refer the figure. I would like to show the figure to you. Look at this. First, try to, the nomenclature is very important compared with the other gears. It's somehow different. You know that this is the center of the worm wheel and this is the center of the worm. This is the center distance denoted by A. And this is a half means D2 by 2. And this is D1 by 2. You can add it. D1 by 2 plus D2 by 2 is equal to, yes, center distance. So I have written here, the center distance is equal to what? A is equal to 1 half D1 plus D2. But what is D1? Again, in terms of M and Q, you can write. What is D2 in terms of M into Z? You can write. The D1 is equal to MQ, D2 is equal to MZ. D2 is equal to MZ to try to understand here. This it should be the Z2, try to understand, it should be the Z2. Okay, it's not a Z1, it's Y. D2 is equal to what? Tell me, M into Z2, that's why it should be Z2. And what is the D1? D1 is equal to, I have already told, M into Q. So you can substitute MQ, take M common from both, the M common Q plus this Z2 here. The A is equal to what you will get, 1 by 2 into M in bracket Q plus Z2. Try to understand. Q plus Z2. This is the correct one. And I have already told ratio, that is Z2 by Z1, that you have to take to find out the velocity. This is about the nomenclature. Then there are two types of, you know, the worm and worm gear drive. One is single enveloping and second one is the double. What do you mean by single enveloping? Single enveloping means in this worm gear, in which gear wraps around or partially and encloses the worms. That means how they are going to mesh or their engagement. It may be partial and it encloses the worm. Try to understand. And because of that, there is a line contact, and single enveloping drive is widely used. How? I will show your figure to you. With me, there is a one diagram, you can refer this. Look at this here, single enveloping. You know the construction for this worm, straight teeth are cut here. And because of that, when this worm wheel is going to mesh here, there is a line contact. And it, you know, the contact between this worm and worm wheel is a partial. But in another double enveloping, in this case, if I am going to draw a worm wheel here, you will find there is a proper meshing, proper wrapping. Wrapping of the worm wheel with the worm, wrapping of the worm with the worm wheel. Try to understand. It's a double enveloping. That's why it is mentioned here in double enveloping, gear wraps around the worm and worm also wraps around the gear. Try to understand. This result in area contact, and this worm in this case in double enveloping gear is also known as cone gearing, and this worm is called hourglass worm. And drive occupies, what is the advantage? Because of this, you know, the wrapping of worm with the worm wheel and worm wheel with the worm, because of that it occupies the less space, and it's a 2/3 of the space or 1/3 of the weight. Because of less occupancy of the space, weight or the machine or element weights also going to decrease is equal to 1/3 of the weight compared with other. Then contact pressure is less, this reduces the wear. But for this double enveloping gear drive, requirement of precise alignment, this is the limitation. Try to understand. So in this way we can use the worm and worm wheel by using single enveloping considering drive and double enveloping drive. Try to understand. It's okay. Then next important point, that is proportions of the worm gear. Try to understand. Proportions means, look at the figure. Try to understand here. I have shown this figure. Now this is nothing but a worm, and this figure is nothing but a worm gear. And here, you know, the axis is in this way, and its axis, that means non-parallel, non-intersecting. And inside view it is drawn here. This is worm. And this is, if you are going to construct inside view here for the worm wheel, you will get, you know, like helical gear construction here. Okay, try to understand these things. Now look at this nomenclature use. And what is, suppose in this case, look at this is the worm wheel, this is the worm. Now in this case, what is D1? I have already told PCD of the worm. What is DA1? Outside diameter, DA1. DA1 is the outside diameter of the worm. Then what is DF1? It's a root. Look at this. It's a root. Because the threads, you know, the worm is in the form of the threads. It's a outer diameter. It's a root. And here it's a PCD. Try to understand. Outer diameter, root diameter, and here we get the PCD. Try to understand these things. Terms, roots. Then the DF1 is the root diameter, D1 is the PCD, and DA1 is the outside diameter, PX is the axial piece, gamma is the lead angle, HA is the addendum, HF is the deadendum. Look at this, from PCD to root, HA1 means outer diameter from this PCD, that is HA1. Okay, but what are the proportions? The addendum of the worm is taken as is equal to modulus. And HF1 means dead endum is taken 2.2 times cos gamma minus 1 into m, standard proportion as per AGMA. And see clearance. Clearance is equal to 0.2 times module into cos gamma. Gamma is the. This is the proportion that you have to use while constructing this worm gear. Those are doing, you know, the worm and worm gas construction. They have to find out all these dimensions. Okay, then how to decide the dimensions for the worm? DA1, outer diameter. I have told addendum, deadendum, clearance. But how to find out this DAM, DA1, DF1? This is related to worm. The DA1 is given. Look at this. Even though by referring to this diagram also, you will get DA1 means this D1 plus, what is this? Here it is written. This is, what is this? From this side it is written HA1, and this side also HA1. So 2 times HA1, it is written DA1 is equal to D1 plus this one. But what is D1? Qntm 2HA1. Here 2HA minus 2 times module, you can substitute in this way. You can find out the dimensions. Then DA1, I have written this, simplifying this, you will get this. Then DF1. What is DF1? This DF1 means root diameter of the worm. Again, you can D1 minus 2HF1. What is HF1? Deadendum. You can substitute this value of deadendum here. You will get this value. In this way, you can find out the dimensions of the worm. Similarly, we can write the dimension for the worm wheel. We can write the dimension for the worm wheel also. Okay, the worm wheel, look at this. I am going to show you what is this DA2. DA2 is the outer diameter. DA2, look at this, outer diameter of the worm wheel. What is D2? PCD of the worm is equal to M into Z2. What is DF1? DF1 is the root diameter of the worm wheel. Try to understand. Again, HA2 means addendum of the worm wheel. In this way, you and HF2 means addendum of the worm wheel. Same, in this fashion, you can note down all the dimensions for the worm wheels also. Okay, it's okay. The next important point is, you can note down in your notebook, effective face width of the worm wheel. How to find out it? You know very well, to have a proper engagement between the worm and worm wheel, proper meshing, the effective face width is important. But look at this. In this case, you will get the idea. Here, this is the what? What is this? This is the worm and this is the worm wheel. Try to understand. You can construct towards this side. This is the worm wheel, this axis. Okay. How it is going to? Now we have to find out this face width of the worm. What you have to do? Consider a triangle. Look at this. This is the D1 means PCD of the worm. Then DA1 means outer diameter of the worm. Try to understand. Then what we have to do? To find out this, we have to consider the triangle AOC. Look at this AOC. And if we are going to consider this triangle, so what is, you can use the Pythagoras formula simply. Here, the AO square is equal to OC square plus AC square. Therefore, AC square is equal to AO square minus OC square. But what is AC? Look at this AC. You will find this is the face width. It's a worm gear face width here. This is F. It is given for a half of this F by 2. So here it is written F by 2. Try to understand how it is written F by 2 bracket square. What is it? Here another one is AO. Try to understand AO. So here it's the, you know, the outer radius of this DA1. But this is half of this, the DA1 by 2 bracket square. And what is OC? Look at this OC. That is half of this D1, the D1 by 2 here. Okay. By referring the dimensions of the worm wheel, can substitute this value. Okay, after substituting this value, you will get this. And you can rearrange the term, you will get F is equal to, you can note down this, 2M plus under root Q plus 1. Q is the diametral question, M is the model. This is the effective face width of the worm wheel. This is F. Okay, this is one thing. Second thing, we have to find out length of root of the worm wheel, that is LR. How to find out the LR? LR means here, how it is going to mesh here in this worm with the worm wheel. How to find out it? So for that purpose, just try to understand first, then I will elaborate. From triangle O, then Z, here shown by blue lines, and up to C1, look at this, this triangle we have to consider. Here, angle included is delta. This delta is equal to sine delta means this C1Z upon what is OZ, you know, sine angle. What is C1Z means again here, this is F by 2. What is this? This is F by 2. You can write F by 2. And what is OZ? It is the outer one. Look at this here. Here it is going to come in contact with the root of the worm wheel. How to take into account? You know very well, up to this it's okay, you have addendum, but it's a root of the worm wheel, and here it's given in figure. You will find from this O to this DA1 plus 2C by 2, that means addendum of the worm plus 2 clearance. 2 means this side clearance and top side clearance, that's why CC is added. DA1 plus 2C by 2. Try to understand. Here it is written DA1 plus 2C by 2. And you can therefore find out delta, this angle delta. Delta is equal to sine inverse of this. Again, what you have to do? Length of what you have to, root of the worm wheel that you have to find. Root of the worm wheel here, this you have to find out. But what is the length of the root? This is root, try to understand it. For this root, If you are going to find out, you have to consider this portion. The length LR is equal to arc XYZ. Here it is written arc XYZ. And how to find out this angle is delta. So that's why this angle is delta. That's why 2 delta. The arc XYZ is equal to 2 delta by 2 pi. And you know that arc is equal to r into theta. This relation you have to simple one. Many times you might have used 2 delta upon this. But here, how this expression is derived, that is the important one. For that purpose, arc XYZ, so you have to consider this to this. So first of all, you can take this arc, then this arc up to the Z. In this way, you can construct the line here. In this, you have calculated delta for this side. Again, you can calculate for this side and you can edit this arc XY and arc YZ. So after substituting these values and putting the value of delta, you will get these terms. Okay. And then what you have to do, you can derive simple one, LR is equal to arc XYZ. And after solving the this, multiplying by this and substituting of this value of delta, that's why sine inverse coming into picture. So you will get the LR is equal to DA1 plus 2. You can do this at home also. Okay, this is about the length of root of the diameter of the worm wheel. Okay, root length of the root of the worm wheel. Try to understand. Then, okay. Thank you. I have referred UV Bhandari's book for this purpose, but I would like this within this worm gear force analysis. Last time we have seen the force analysis of spur gear, helical gear, and other this. While doing this analysis, some assumptions are made here. Driving element is worm, driven element is worm wheel. Again, type of threads are required, whether it is right-handed or left-handed. Why it is required? If it's a right-handed, we have to use a thumb rule, you have to use a right hand, or whether direction of rotation. Accordingly, we are going to use a thumb rule and thumb decides the direction of the axial force. That's why we have to decide the type of a thread, whether right-handed or left-handed. Then direction of rotation, whether worm rotates in anti-clockwise, clockwise. Then by considering or assuming this thing, what we have to do, we have to carry out the force analysis. It's okay, right? But you know very well, worm and worm wheel is subjected to three components of gear tooth pore size. First one is the tangential components. It is helpful to transmit the motion or a power. Second one is the axial component. Why axial component? Because the threads or the teeth which cut on the screw or a worm is having some inclination, it made some angle. That's why axial force. Again, the helical or a worm wheel is also having, you know, the if it's a spiral one, the teeth cuts having some inclination, there may be axial component. Radial component, you know very well, separating one, it's x towards the center. The three component that we have to take into account in case of worm and worm wheel. But how to decide, I will show you. Look at this. Try to understand. It's not easy to show it on a 2D plane, all the forces, because you look at this. This is the worm and this is the gear. How they are going to miss is, you know very well, this is the axis of the worm and this is the axis of the worm wheel. If I am going to construct this worm wheel in a paper, I will get this. And here I will get, you know, the rectangle for the worm wheel. That you can observe the worm wheel side view here and in front view rectangle for this. And if you are going to observe inside view worm wheel as a circle, you will observe the rectangle in top view for a worm. That's why it's very difficult to accommodate and put the forces. That's why I try to understand the things associated with the force analysis. Now look at this. A is the observer. This is the worm. And it rotates in anti-clockwise direction. You know very well, like a spur and helical gear. And it's a driving. You know the worm is the driving unit. So here, where will get the tangential force? Always in case of spur and helical, I have already told. The tangential component which is opposite to the direction of rotation for a driver. In this case also, worm is the driving unit or a driving gear. That's why PT, tangential component which is opposite to the direction of rotation of this worm. Try to understand. That's why PT1 in this direction. P1R. Radial force acts always towards the center. One is suffix is used for the worm and two suffix is used for the worm wheel or a worm gear. Try to understand these things. Okay, so this is the PT1 opposite to the rotation. Then P1R radial force. But so how this P1A decided? You know very well, we have considered right hand thread. Then direction of rotation is the left, is here the observer. Anti-clockwise direction, not the left, it's anti-clockwise. Look at this, if you are an observer and it's anti-clockwise and right hand thread, what you have to do? You know thumb rule, you have to use a right hand. Direction of rotation in this way, so you can put your thumb in this fashion. The thumb decides axial direction, that's why. I have shown here P1A axial force of the worm towards this side. I hope you got it. The PT1, why opposite? Direction of rotation of the worm, opposite one, P1R, PT. But again here P22, look at this. This is the worm wheel. You know very well, it rotates in opposite to this direction of the worm. And like a spur helical gear, tangential component of this worm wheel, which is acts in the same direction of rotation, P22. Look at this, it rotates in this direction, so P22 acts in this direction. Okay, and I am going to put all these forces by constructing 2D plane here. Look at this. Now you will observe these things. It's very important. Try to understand these things. Now in this case, I have constructed this figure here, a observer inside view. It rotates in anti-clockwise, that's PT1 opposite to that. I have constructed the same figure here. And P1A shows towards this side. Why? I have already told, it's having a right hand. Then rotation in this way, that was axial force this side. That's why I have shown by red color here. And P1R, this is for the worm. Similarly, you will find here, direction of rotation of the worm will opposite P22 in this way and PR2 here. But if you are going to observe here inside view of the worm wheel, you will find at this position, you will get the P2A component. But looking to this, you will find P1T component is equal to P2A component. P1R is equal to P2R. And P2T is equal to P1. Look at this opposite direction. But that's why you have to require to construct 2D or two side views, front side, then you can write this, right on there. That means P, tangential component of the worm is equal to axial component of the worm wheel. Tangential component of the worm wheel is equal to axial component of the worm, and radial component of the worm is equal to radial component of the worm wheel. Try to understand these things. In this way, we can find out the magnitude. That's why I am going to write P2T is equal to P1A, P2A is equal to P1T, and PR radial same. But they are acting in opposite direction. That's why I have written it here. I hope you got it. But how to find out the magnitude of these components? How to find out the magnitude of these components? For that purpose, here in worm, there are two components which plays. You know, in spur and helical gear, normal reaction or to find out the resultant force, we have considered only normal reactions. And based on that normal reaction, we have calculated the resultant forces in case of spur and helical gear. But in case of worm, there are two components. Component of normal reaction, this is one. And second one is the component of frictional force. Why frictional force? There is a, along with rolling motion, there is a sliding motion. And because of this, there is a frictional force which is going to act along the thread of the worm, but in opposite direction. That's why to find out the resultant forces, you will get here component due to normal reaction and component due to frictional forces. And we have to add this to get the resultant force acting on the worm. That's why we have to superimpose these components. Okay, how to do it? Let us see. Consider the first case. First means components of normal reaction. To look at this, this is the worm which rotates anti-clockwise direction. This is the pitch cylinder of the worm. Look at this. Now you know this is the pitch point, suppose, and this is the helix here, pitch helix. Look at this, I am constructing this point where the worm gear is coming in contact at the pitch point. And you know very well, at this point PT, which acts opposite to the direction of rotation, PA, you know very well, towards this side we have already shown PR here, this direction of rotation in this way. Okay, but you know very well how to find out the normal reaction. The P is the force, you know, the resultant here, P, which acts here. You know very well, like a helical gear also we have carried out the analysis. Here the gamma is the thread angle, which is made by this PN. Again, you can say it's a PR, or what is this? This is the P axial, but this P makes an angle of alpha, pressure angle alpha here. It makes an pressure angle alpha when we are going to consider this here. So what we have to do to find out these components of normal reaction, we have to consider this top plane. This is EBFA, and another second plane ABC and D. Look at this ABCD, where you will get the P, and in top plane you will get the PN, making an angle of thread, that is gamma for the top, and alpha pressure angle, normal pressure angle for this plane AB. Considering this plane, you will get the components of the normal reaction. That's why I am going to take these components. Look at this. So you can consider the ABCD plane is considered. Here it's a PN, then it's a P, and it's a PR. So you can consider ABCD. Here you will find PN. How to find out PN? The cos alpha is equal to, you will get this tangent and adjacent side, this, the PN is equal to P cos alpha. Similarly, PR means sine, so you will get P sine alpha. Okay, then resolve, consider the another plane AEBF, top plane. So you will find here, when you are going to consider this plane, find out the this PA. PA one is suffix is used because of the verb P1A, you can say. Okay, and P1T for the tangential component. You will get here, this is the gamma. So you can consider this angle P11A, or you can write this is the P also, no problem. This component P1A is equal to PN cos gamma, and PT is equal to PN. Simple one. So you can substitute here. What is PN? P cos alpha. You have to substitute here. What is PR? P sine alpha. Or you can say PN IN here. So you will, after substituting, PN is equal to P cos alpha. P1A becomes P cos alpha upon cos gamma, and P1T becomes P cos alpha into sine gamma. And you know very well PR1, if you are going to find out it, so what you will get here in this, here already written for the worm, P1R is equal to P sine alpha. So you will get, this is the axial component, this is the tangential, and this is the radial, because of this the normal reaction. But there is another component because of friction that we have to consider. Look at this. Now component of friction, which is coming into picture, and this frictional force mu P, you know the friction is coefficient of friction P, and this force. Look at this. Again, this is the gear which rotates in anticlockwise. A gear means worm. Again, this is the pitch of the helix, but this mu P, which acts opposite to the direction of rotation, frictional force opposite to the direction. Try to understand. And here this gamma is the lead angle, you know very well. Gamma means the tangent drawn to these, the helix, and the normal drawn to the worm. This angle is the lead angle. This is the gamma. The mu P is having two component. One is vertical in this way, and one is the horizontal. So you can resolve mu P. So resolving mu P, you will get here this component is the mu P cos gamma, and horizontal component is mu P sine gamma. But look at this. This component mu P cos gamma, which is opposite to the direction, opposite to the direction of rotation, and mu P, it acts towards this side, which is opposite to the axial force PA1, which is opposite to the axial force. So you have, what you have to do, while superimposing the component PA1 of the worm for the normal reaction, you can substitute mu P sine gamma. Why? Because it acts opposite. Here also, it is opposite to this direction of rotation and tangential. You look at this. Direction of rotation of the worm in this side, the PT1, P1T or PT1, which acts opposite to the direction. And this component of the frictional force mu P cos gamma is also in the same direction. So you can add direct P1T from the normal reaction and this component. Okay, I will show you. Look at this. The P1A, we have to find out after superimposing. normal reaction component and frictional force component. How? P cos alpha into cos gamma. This is the component we have derived from what? Look at this. We have derived, 1 minute, we have derived it from, I would like to show here, P1A. This is from the reactions. PT1 also from the reaction. And that we have to superimpose. Try to understand. We are going to superimpose. Superimposing this, I will erase all these things. Okay. P1A is equal to P1 cos. Now here axial component is x in this direction. But here mu p frictional force acts opposite to that. So that's why negative sign minus mu p sine gamma. Try to understand why minus sign is used. Mu p sine alpha sine gamma is the frictional force horizontal component which acts opposite to the axial force which acts on work. That's why you have to use minus sign. And what's about the tangential component? Here it's rotate in this case. The P1T is P1T acts opposite to the rotation. The P1T plus this component mu P cos gamma, which is in the same direction. So you can add it. So you can write P1T coming from normal reaction P cos alpha into sine gamma plus what? This mu P cos gamma. So you will get P1A and P1T. Okay. After getting this, the P in both the terms, P common, P is taken outside here. And P1R remains same. As it for calculated for normal reaction, you can use the same value. That means after superposing, we have to find out the magnitude of P1A, P1R and P1T. How to find out? So what you have to do? P1A upon P1T. You can take this ratio. P is equal to this value and this value. So you what PP gets cancelled, you can set P1 to towards that side, P1E is equal to P12 into this. By using this expression, you can find out the magnitude of axial component. And once you will get a P1A, P1A is nothing but a P2T. Try to understand. Then second, you have to find out the P1R. How to find out P1R? Take the ratio. P1R is equal to P1T. Again, PP gets cancelled. You can say towards this side, you will get P1R is equal to P1T into this term. But again, P1R is equal to what? P1R is equal to P2R. And then third one, P1T. P1T means, as the, you know, the worm is the driving unit, driving gear from the power and RPM, you will get the torque. 2 into MT upon D1 is the PCD of the worm. You will get the P1T. And P1T is equal to, again, what? P2A. Try to understand. So in this way, by using this relation, you can find out the forces induced in the worm and worm wheel. Thank you. I have reported Vivi Bhandari's book. Thank you.